Good morning, sir. See, it's not on y'all, it's not on time. This morning, if you'll take your bulletins, open it up, we got a couple of announcements that we need to make. Make sure that you're aware of. I want you to be a part of. First and foremost, there is a table set up outside in the foyer. I want to encourage you to write a note, to write a thank you, to the Gurley family, Ashley and Bubba. They feel that God has called them to move on, and we want to bless them. We want to let them know how much we love them and appreciate their service. There's also a gift box out there, and if you would like to and to bless them, make sure that you put something in that gift box. Tonight, we will be over in the fellowship hall. We'll start at 6. There will not be any Bible study this afternoon. We'll start at 6, and we'll have a reception for the Gurley family. We want you to be a part of that. Come love on them. Again, we want you to come and join. Make sure that you bring your finger foods and be a part of that. We want to encourage you to do that so much. At 6 o'clock tonight, don't forget. Now, there's a second announcement that we need to make that is very important. I want you to understand how hard this is. We had a young man who went to the state Bible drill. And I'd almost bet none of y'all in this room, outside of a couple, could do what he did. He had to make less than 4 mistakes in the Bible drill. That's important because they had to find scripture, they had to quote scripture. You watched Bible drills before. This is a great accomplishment. We ought to be proud of the church that we have people who are willing to teach that, who are willing to go along with that and help them out. Hey, Mark, where you at?
Up here.
He's up there. Y'all give Hayden a hand. You can read the other ones in your bulletin if you will. If you're a first-time visitor to Three Creeks Baptist Church, we want to welcome you. We thank you that you're here. We want to give you a little opportunity to fill out the visitor card that's in the pew in front of you. And if you'll fill that card out, you got the whole service to do that. You can give that to me and Kim out the back door. We'd love to meet you, and we have a little gift for you. If you will come by and give us that visitor card, we'd appreciate it. Now I'm going to ask the church family to rise, the visitors to stay seated. Y'all go find a visitor. Y'all go find somebody you hadn't spoken to this morning and bring them by.
Yeah.
Can we make you, we have a couple of treats for you this morning. Just to share, as everybody's making their way back to this, your pews and designated seats this morning. Dano failed to mention, but I want to point out there are some very good men in this church. At least seven of them I know. We got two treats this morning. If you didn't know, Brother Dano and myself got the great treat of going with some ladies from the church to a women's conference this weekend. So.
Jesus said to him, "Away with you, Satan, for it is written, you shall worship the Lord your God, and him only you shall serve."
Thank you. Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name when I'm found in the desert place, though I walk through the wilderness. Blessed be your name. Every blessing you pour out, turn back to praise. When the darkness closes in, Lord, still I will say, blessed be the name of the Lord, blessed be your name, blessed be the name.
Pray for the Curley family as they go their way. Bless them and prosper. We want to thank you now for the privilege to give back to you just a part of what you've already given us. In Jesus' name we pray.
Take my life. Two more songs.
And I want you just to come straight from my heart this morning.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply go. Longing just to bring something that's a word that will bless your heart. Bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into
Jesus, your name is life.
If you have your Bibles, if you would, turn to John chapter 5 this morning. John chapter 5, and we'll begin in the latter part of the ninth verse. He is worthy. He is worthy whether you have anything or not. He is worthy whether you have money or not.
He is worthy whether you have sickness or not. He is worthy whether you have a spouse or not. He is worthy whether you have a teacher or not. He is worthy whether you have a pastor or not. He is always worthy of our praise. That's who He is. There's only one thing or one time that I've been in a service where they have been a group of people that God has stirred me like He did at the end of the service. That was at the end of a men's conference, and they did the same thing. And you can imagine 5,000 men singing. Men, not ladies, men. He's worthy of our praise. Whether we can sing or not, He is worthy of our praise. My mother, bless her heart, couldn't carry a tune in a bucket, a wheelbarrow, or a pickup truck. We were in vacation Bible school, and my mother was sitting behind us, and one of the kids turned around and looked at her and said, "Miss Rainer, why aren't you singing?" And she said, "Well, I don't sing well." And he said, "Well, it's okay." Well, the next day in vacation Bible school, she thought, "Well, you know what, I'll just make a joyful noise to the Lord." She was behind us, and she began to sing, and one of the students turned around and looked at her and said, "Miss Rainer, you can't sing." She said, "That's all right, I'm making a joyful noise to the Lord." You see, He's worthy whether we can sing or not. He is worthy whether we can read music or not. He is worthy whether we can speak or not. He is worthy to be our Lord. He is Lord in sickness, He is Lord in death, and He is Lord in life. And He is the giver of life. He can heal, but He also can hold your hand in that sickness. He is the giver of life and peace and love and joy. This morning, I want you to understand that He is worthy. Sometimes we have to get to a place in our life or spiritually in a place that we have to stop and be still. I was in that place this week. I was able to get still Friday. I dropped the ladies off at their conference thing, and I went back to the hotel room, and I spread all my books out, and I spread my Bible out, and I got still. Was able to have a good quiet time with the Lord and good quiet time period. No phone ringing, no internet dinging. But it wasn't till that last song that the Lord began to stir my heart. You see, the Lord must work in your life, in Christian's life, before He can stir the world. He must stir in the hearts of Christians before He can stir into the world, because He uses us as Christians, those who are true followers of His, to stand up and to preach and to teach and to show the world the truth. And the truth is that we have a Lord regardless, and He is worthy regardless of what's going on in your life. Whether you're homeless or not, He is worthy of our praise. And we need not be distracted by that. If I didn't learn anything this weekend, I learned that I should not allow someone, something, or some situation to distract me from His worth. And neither should you. You see, I want us as a church to be excited about what God could do through us. I want us to get off of our royal hind ends and get on our feet and stand in our place. My pastor used to say that you have a place around the camp and you should be in it. You see, we have allowed people to distract us. We've allowed things of this world to distract us of who we're called to be. We've allowed this world to distract us from His worthiness. You see, it's not about me and it's not about you. It's all about Him. And if we get distracted from that, whatever may come, whatever may happen, if we get distracted from that, we fall and we fail to show the world how much Christ loves us and them. The love of rules and traditions and possessions, more than people, can creep into our lives subtly and in dangerous ways. If we begin to love the structure, if we begin to love the rules, if we begin to love our traditions, or we begin to love our possessions, and our family can become our possessions more than we love the lost, then we're saying to him, he's not worthy. If we're not willing to be committed to him, why should he be committed to us? Yet he is. He is always worthy. He is always standing there waiting on us for us to say, yes, Lord, you are worthy. You're worthy of my praise. You're worthy of my time. You're worthy of my family. And you're worthy of my money. You are simply worthy. Yet I look around our congregation this morning and please don't take this wrong, because I know where you're coming from. I've been in the same place you are. I understand work. I understand ball. I understand cheer. And I understand all those things. But when we allow those things to distract us from who is worthy, then we're falling behind. You see, if we are not moving forward in God's word and God's life and what God has for us, we're sliding backwards. There is no such thing as sitting still. God wants us moving. That's the reason he told us in Matthew that for us to go and make disciples. How many people see Christ in you? Is he worthy enough for you to show him to somebody else? Is he worthy enough for you to get involved and say, you know what? I'm tired of living the life I'm living. I'm tired of being beat down. I'm tired of things going wrong. And I'm going to come, and I'm going to be committed to this church. I'm going to be committed to what God called me to do. Regardless of what comes, because, not because of you, Pastor, not because we have a beautiful building, not because we have all these things, but because he is worthy. He is. We've got to get that in our heads as Christians. He is worthy. He is worthy of our praise. He is worthy of this very ridiculous life that I live. If we look in chapter 5 and we see that Jesus is healing people, Jesus is reaching out to people, and he's trying to heal people in ways that the church don't like. You see, I want revival to break out. I do. You know where revival starts? Not with me, but in my heart. It starts in your heart. It starts when you say, you know what, Lord? Here I am. As beaten, battered, and as messed up as it is, here I am. Take me. Jesus wants to heal us of our ailments, not necessarily physically, but spiritually. He wants to take us and mold us and make us into the image of his Son, Jesus Christ. You cannot do that if you're not in his word or with his family. You say, well, Pastor, you're being kind of ugly this morning. No, I'm not. I just love you enough to tell you the truth. When we allow the world to distract us of his worthiness, we are failing. Tremendously, we are failing. When we begin to find or carry a person's worth more than we carry the worth of Jesus Christ, we are failing. So many of us get to the point where we think, well, you know, I can't tithe this week because I don't have enough money to tithe. I can't give my tithes because I don't have enough money to pay my bills. I can't tithe this week because of something else. I got to pay for a ball suit or a cheer suit, or I got to pay for something else, and I don't have time to tithe. Let me tell you something. You cannot outgive God. As much as you try, you cannot outgive God. I understand. I used to struggle with it all my life. I struggled with, Lord, I ain't got enough money to pay my bills. How in the world can I give something to the church? They already got plenty. Maybe they ought to be giving me some. You hear me? You understand what I'm saying? But my God's bigger than that. You can't outgive him. You give him a tithe, you'll have the money. Now, you may not have the pretty shiny. I tried to get Kim to buy me a boat this weekend. We went in the Bass Pro Shop in Memphis. Have mercy. I was drooling, but, you know, sorry. We got ready to go out to the back door, and there's a big old shiny. Boy, that thing was pretty. I looked at that price tag on that boat, and I said, here, this is your pocket change. $78,000 for a boat. Huh? Oh, needless to say, I didn't get a boat. He may not give you that, but he'll give you peace, comfort, and the things that this world can't give you. Not because he can't, but because he knows what's best for us. He knows what encourages us to follow him. This morning, if you don't get anything else, he's worthy of your life. He's worthy of your praise. He's worthy of your time. He is worthy of your commitment. And I promise you, if you'll commit to him and you'll commit to his work, he will never fail you. Not ever. You say, well, Pastor, I got cancer, and I didn't want that, but I commit to the Lord. Commit to him. Because I tell you what, he's bigger than any cancer this world ever throw on you. He's bigger than any divorce that this world will throw on you. He's bigger than any money problem the world will throw on you. He's bigger than any drug problem that the world can throw on you. He can overcome anything because he overcame death. And he rose up out of that grave on the third day in victory. You see, I'm just fighting battles. The war's already been won. I can rest in that. I told y'all last week, the older I get, the better I can see those gates and how wonderful they're going to be. That was just the first part of the sermon. I didn't get started yet. I want you to rise out of reverence to the reading of God's holy, infallible word. That was just something that was on my heart this morning, something that God had laid on extra. I just want to hear you, and I want the church to, I just want us to have revival. And it starts in our heart. It doesn't start in our things, it starts in our heart. John chapter 5, in the verse 9, it says, now that day was the Sabbath. So the Jews said to the man who had been healed, is it the Sabbath? Is it not lawful for you to take up your bed? But he answered them, the man who healed me and said to me, take up your bed and walk. They asked him, who is the man who said that to you? Take up your bed and walk. Now the man who had healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had withdrawn, as there was a crowd in the place. Afterwards, Jesus found him in the temple and said to him, see, you are well. Sin no more, that nothing worse may happen to you. The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. And this was why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, my Father is working until now, and I am working. This is why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making him equal with God. Let's pray. Father God, I thank you for this day. Father, I thank you for your blessing. I thank you for, Father, calling someone who is unworthy to preach your worthy word. And Father, as Russ has already asked, Father, I ask you to remove me from this pulpit. Father, that your word will go forth, because my word doesn't mean anything, can't change anything. But Father, your word can create things and change things in an instant. And Father, I just ask that you bless this time we have together, that you hadn't already, Father, but I ask you to continue to bless it. Father, help stir revival in this place. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. There are several things in this scripture that we need to look at, that we need to pull out. And if you remember, if you've been here for a little while, you've heard me talk about divine appointments. There was a divine appointment with Jesus and the lady at the well. But there's also a divine appointment in this. And it says, now the day was Sabbath. And Jesus had a divine appointment with the church. Being the Jews, being the ones who are part of the synagogue, he had a divine appointment with these men, and it was on the Sabbath. It wasn't with a certain person, it was with the church. You see, as a church, we become indoctrinated. As I read a quote earlier, that we begin to love rules and traditions. We let those things move into our hearts and move into their lives. And I'm not saying that traditions and things are bad. I'm just saying that we don't need to hold them as scripture, as the word of God. We got to build on something. They're not bad. We just need to hold the word of God higher. We need to be truer to the word of God than to a church doctrine. Now on that day was the Sabbath. So the Jews said to the man, "Who healed you? It's the Sabbath. How dare you do anything good on the Sabbath? How dare you do anything outside of what our doctrine tells you, what our laws tell you to do? How dare you love a man enough to show him Christ? How dare you walk down the street and show some kindness to somebody? How dare you do those things because we didn't ask you to do that, because we got laws against you doing stuff on the Sabbath? How dare you? Have you lost your mind? You want to go out and witness to somebody on Sunday afternoon? You want to go clean up somebody's yard on Sunday afternoon? You want to reach out into the community on Sunday afternoon? How dare you? It's Sunday. You're supposed to go home and eat dinner and go to sleep, because the preacher spit on the first row. How dare you? Lord, have mercy. We be the church. Jesus is setting a standard here. For love and for kindness, for reaching the lost. And they were so worried about losing their notoriety, they were so worried about losing who they were, that they didn't see Jesus did a miracle before them. Have mercy, he healed a man. Oh, well, we can't have you healing on Sunday. Well, that's just out. That don't, wait a minute, let me check the bylaws. You can't heal people on Sunday. The bylaws say you can't heal people on Sunday. The church doctrine says you can't heal people on Sunday. You can't do that. You need to quit. Jesus was moving in the midst of these people, and they missed it. How many times have we been sitting in the church, and we know that God is moving in our life, we know that God is moving in the church, and we just sit there and we miss it? We don't come to the altar when he calls us to the altar. Not to the preacher, but to bow before a holy cross, to bow before a holy God. How many times do we miss it? Because we're so wrapped up in our own life. Well, for heaven's sake, somebody see me go to the altar. For heaven's sake, somebody know that there's something wrong in my life. For heaven's sake, somebody know that I'm not right with Jesus. I can't do that. Jesus wants to heal. He wants to heal on Sunday. But he don't necessarily want to heal your ailments. He wants to heal your heart. Because that's what we need more than anything. I'd love to see the altar full of people. I think heaven rejoices when we stand before the cross. When we stand there with our arms open wide and our hearts ripped open so that he can change us into the image of Jesus. But it's the Sabbath, preacher. We might miss the white meat. We can't come back to church tonight because the fish is biting. We can't come. Well, wait a minute. We're not even supposed to have church anyway on Sunday night, right? That just breaks up too much. We can't do that. We got to go do other things. It's my only day off. I guess it's my day to hurt y'all's feelings. Preacher, I don't get one day off. What better day and what better way to spend it than in the presence of the Lord? I've said this 100 times. I'm going to say it again. God has blessed me. I have been unfaithful. I have been rude. I have been lazy. I have done all kinds of things in my life. But every time I call upon the cross, God has changed my life and He has brought me in regardless of who I am. When God called me to seminary, Kim said, "I ain't doing your homework for you." I knew God called me to seminary because I wouldn't have went on my own, I promise you. I couldn't write. If I got a paragraph down, I'd be lucky. And in seminary, you had to write papers. Whether they're 2 pages, 5 pages, 20 pages, 25 pages. You had to write. Well, you know, God, I got basically a full-time youth ministry. I was bivocational, but it was wide open. I just don't know if I can do that. Well, God, I got a full-time job. I'm on call 364 days a year. Only one day that I get to be off call. It's because Walmart's closed on Christmas Day. That's the only day I got off for sure. Lord, I ain't got time for that. I can't do that. There's no way that I can do that, God. And He said, "Just commit to me, and I'll see you through it." I don't know how. I do, by the grace of God and by the power of God, how I got home some nights. Because I was so tired, because I'd study till 2 a.m. and get up at 6 and go to work. I found rest in the Father. I found peace in the Father. Commit to it. He will give you rest and He will give you peace in the midst of chaos. It's by His grace. We had a lady, and I've told y'all before, a man actually, he taught study skills. I don't know why he thought I needed somebody to teach me study skills. That's what he taught at the college. Told him, he said, "I'll be glad to help him anytime he wants. I'll be glad to help him through it all. I'll help him do whatever he needs to do." And she said, "I don't think you want to do that." Oh, he was being nice. I mean, he wanted to. He said, I don't think you want to do that." "Oh, yeah, I do." She said, "Okay." Well, he studies between 12 and 2 at night. He said, "Oh, no, never mind." God's good. That's what I'm trying to tell you. That's what I want you to hear. You think your problems are big? They're absolutely nothing with God. We need to be about God's business every day. Every day. We shouldn't miss the assembling of each other together, but we need to be about God's business 7 days a week. How dare you, somebody heal you, and you do what they tell you to do? It's not lawful for you to take up your bed. But the man was a whole lot like Adam. It wasn't me, it was him. It wasn't me, I didn't do it. Eve's the one that ate that apple, I didn't do it. Deflect it. How many times do we deflect to somebody else? Well, it's somebody else's fault I'm not in church. It's somebody else's fault that I got to do this, or it's somebody else's fault that I got to do that. Why are we not spending time with God? Because I got something else to do. I got things to do. Okay. Make another excuse. Eve didn't do it. They both did it. We could come up with excuses. I told y'all about that little saying my wife got. And she uses on me quite frequently, not as much as she used to. Let me see if I can get it right. You do what is important to you. Let that sink in a minute. That just infuriates me. I mean, it does. You do what is important to you. You know why that infuriates me? Because it's truth. If God is important to you, you will commit to Him. And you will commit to His service if He's important to you. You'll commit to doing His work if He's important to you. Now the man who had been healed didn't know who it was because Jesus withdrew Himself from the crowd. And afterwards, Jesus found him. You understand that He found him in the temple. And it was time of festival. There were thousands of people in this place. There were thousands of people at the temple. But Jesus found one person out of thousands. He took the time to go and find this man. He took out of thousands to have a face-to-face meeting with him. He found him and he changed his life. Jesus is looking for you. Out of the thousands and the millions of people on this earth, he wants to have a conversation with you. And only you. And he is there. He is waiting for that conversation. Jesus sought that man out. He is seeking us out every day. And he said to him, "See, you are well." If you'll commit to Jesus, if you'll lay your life down to Him, He can say the same thing to you. It is well. See, it is well. See what I tried to tell you? See what I tried to tell you 10 years ago, 5 years ago, 5 days ago? It is well. It's not temporary. It's eternal. When Jesus changes your heart, when you get to know Him as your Lord and Savior, it is not one day, it's not one month, it's not 10 years. It is eternal salvation. And it is well. You see, Jesus confronted him. He knew him. He said, "Look, dude, it wasn't temporary, was it? When I heal you completely. There's absolutely that can remove nothing that can remove you from Jesus' hand when you ask Him into your life." He didn't say it wasn't going to be trouble. He didn't say you weren't going to get thrown in the lion's den. He's just going to be there with you. How else am I going to grow? How else am I going to need to find those dark places in my heart that need to be removed? How else can I be conformed to Him? By those trials and those troubles, by the struggles of life. As long as we commit to Him. It says, "See, it's well." That's what He wants to tell us. That's what He wants to share with us. He says, "Sin no more, that nothing worse can happen to you." Turn with me to John chapter 9, verse 3. I want you to know this. I want you to hear this. John chapter 9, verse 3. I'll begin in the first verse. It says, "As he passed by, he saw a blind man from birth, and the disciples asked him again, 'Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind?' Jesus answered, 'It was not this man's sin or his parents, but the works of God might be displayed in him.'" The trouble that you're going through right now, he may be displaying him or himself to a world that don't know him. When we're being pulled through the fire, God's at work. Not only in our life, but in the world's life. Not only in your life, but somebody else's life. You need to understand it's not about sin, not about those things. It's about having faith in God, putting our faith in Him. It's about salvation in Him. He's talking about the separation. Jesus is offering him salvation. And he says, don't turn from it. Don't run from it. There may be somebody in this room that's been running from the Lord. Jesus said, it's okay, come back. I'm here. I'm waiting. I want to make it well in your life. Y'all, it should scare us that we got people sitting in this room that's going to go to hell. Because they've been in church all their life, or they've been a part of church all their life, or they know that it's good to come to church, but they've never met the healer. They've never met the Lord Jesus Christ. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about committing to the Lord, laying your life before the Lord, asking for God for that salvation so that it can be well in your soul, so that you can be like him, so that you will know one day you'll stand with him, and as Russ said, man, that's what heaven's going to be like. You got the video of that? Y'all go listen to the video of them ladies singing. That's what heaven's going to be like. It's just going to have some of us old gruff men in the middle of it. That's what he's waiting on. He's waiting on you to commit. They were more concerned about their law than they were God's law. They were more concerned with the laws than they were with people's lives. Are we that way? The man went away and told the Jews that Jesus is the one that healed him. And this is why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. He was working on the Sabbath. They hated him because he killed their laws. They hated him because he was taking their fame. They hated him because he was the truth. Because they were more concerned about themselves than they were winning the law. They had already begun to persecute him. They had already begun to talk about him. They had already begun being setting up events so that they could trap him, so that they could put him in a place where he would fall or stumble. How dare him do these things? But Jesus answered them and said, my Father is working until now, and I am working. There's something I'd like to do. And I'm going to pitch this, and y'all going to have a heart attack. There's something I'd like to start doing for those who want to and those who feel led. I feel a personnel meeting coming. I think it's time for us to be the church. Not just come to church, but to be the church. The days are getting longer. We can get a lot done between now and dark. See, I'd like for us to meet up here on Sunday afternoons and go out into the community. Clean up somebody's yard. Build a ramp. Share Jesus with the lost. Well, how dare you? Does it matter how we reach the lost? Whether we do it in a church service or whether we do it on the field? Well, Pastor, we've always had church on Sunday night. I'm not talking about stopping it. I'm not talking about stopping having church on Sunday night, because I believe in church on Sunday night. But I'd like for us to take a couple of Sunday nights a month and go out in the community and share Jesus with the lost. That's what Jesus was doing. He was just sharing himself with the lost. It doesn't matter what day you do it on. It matters what's in here. That's all that matters. You see, when we're doing God's work, which we should be doing every day, not just Sunday, we're doing absolutely nothing wrong. Well, then that means I can work on Sunday, right? That ain't what I'm saying. If we are doing the Father's work, there should be nothing wrong with it. Jesus was doing the Father's work. He has given us that same commission to go and to do His work. This is why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill Him, because He was breaking the Sabbath, but He was even calling God His own Father for making Himself equal with God. You see, there were two problems the Jews had. He was working on Sunday, and He was telling them that He was the Son of God. What a problem to have. You see, the work He was refraining from doing was His regular employment. Acts of mercy, kindness, to benefit the others, to win the lost, is the work of the Father. The Lord of healing and the Lord of rest invites you to come and be refreshed and restored as you fellowship with Him. Last question of the day. Will you submit to the authority of Jesus? Will you commit your life to doing what He asks you to do? I don't want you to commit to me. Let me see the best way to phrase that. I love all of y'all, and I want every one of y'all to like me. But I want you to love Jesus first. I don't want you to come do it for me because you'll fail. I don't want you to come do it for a church because you will fail. I want you to come do it for Jesus because He'll never fail. Not ever. He will give you rest and peace in the days of suffering, in the days of hurt, in these days that are getting worse. Are you going to rebel or are you going to submit? Jesus can heal, but He also can give you rest. Let's pray. Father God, I thank You for this day. Father, I thank You for the love and the grace that You give me. Father, I know that You extend that to the world. And Father, I know that there's people in this room today that are hurting. Father, that there's people in this room that, Father, think that they can't make it to the next day, and yet You're screaming loudly, I am worthy. And Father, we all know that You are. Father, I ask that You bring us together as brothers and sisters. Father, that You help us to find the place to serve You. Father, if You're laying something on someone's heart this morning, Father, that they need to do or they think that they need to do, Father. Father, don't let them leave this place, Father. Let them commit to Your work. Let them commit to You. Help us to quit making church an afterthought. Father, there's somebody in this room that doesn't know You. Father, it doesn't matter what age they are. Father, if they don't know You, I pray that You don't let them leave this room without You. Father, break their heart so that You can heal it for eternity. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You can stand.
Revealing you are Christ. What a beautiful
Thank you for being here today. Thank you for being God's house. Thank you for being faithful to the calling that's on your life. And I pray that you will continue to grow in that. I pray that you continue to do what God has called you to do without fear, without wonder, and in His peace. Because only He can give you that peace. If you stood there and held on to the back of that pew and your knuckles are white, it's not over yet. Until you take your last breath, it's not over. God will pursue you. God will look for you because God loves you. And anytime you want to bow before Him, He is waiting with open arms.